everybody, welcome to Avon Park Raceway. We're here at the finals day and we're being rained off. It's terrible, the weather is awful, but it hasn't been like that all the way throughout the year. We've seen some absolutely superb summer weather. Welcome to our video. Let's have a look and see what went on in 1999 at the Super Series. Preparation in the pits has been fast and furious. This is the race day that we're going to be looking at here at Avon Park, following 2 days of practice and qualifying. And have we seen some electric qualifying from all of our various classes? None more so, however, than in Pro Modified Car. Let's have a word with last year's champion.
Well, what a weekend, eh? You come back, last year's champion, and mega problems for you all the way through the weekend. Tell us what you've been doing.
Well, we broke a rocker first thing on Saturday morning, the first pass, and Clive Bond actually delivered one for us, which was quite good. Then we put that back on, then we went up and made another pass, which should have been a better pass after we bedded the new engine in. And all hell let loose in the clutch. We destroyed the whole clutch in one pass.
Okay, let's hear about the new rules that apply to Pro Stock bike. Here's Paul Willis.
Well, what's really stunning me is the newfound increase in power that the Pro Stock bikes have managed to achieve. And of course, you are the man that's made most use of this, number one this weekend. Tell me why there's this sudden surge of power.
With the new rules that came in for this year, we've been allowed to increase the capacity on the engines, and that's made the biggest increase. And we spent all winter doing a new engine.
So when you say there's new rules, just run through those for me now.
Last year we were restricted to a maximum of 1325cc. We're now up to a maximum of 1500.
And that's with 4 valves per cylinder?
With 4 valves or 2 valves, it's a maximum of 1500. And it's given the 4-valve engines a big increase in power.
Well, a very confident Paul Willis and the crowd eagerly waiting the racing, basking in this beautiful sunshine here. But as always, a little bit of sadness comes to every bit of joy. The crew remember one of their lost colleagues, Anya Yates, who died shortly before the meeting. We join the semi-finals of Super Street, the 1090 class, and look at this, a Mustang against the E-Type Jaguar. My goodness me. Now then, reaction times are all important here. The man in the E-Type Jaguar was last year's champ. The man in the blue Mustang was last year's number two. Who's going to take the win? It's so very, very close. Out goes last year's champion. It was Bob Lees in the Ford Mustang who took the win, so we know it's going to be an all-Ford final. In the Mark II console, it's Martin Green. Lee Huxley is in that black Roadster. Now, good start line reactions, a 53 to a 78. Wow, it's the battle of the breakouts again. And Lee Huxley breaks out by the least and moves into the final. It's all Fords here at the moment, isn't it? That was a Ford Mustang going through the burnout. Dave Pollen, remember he had all those problems at the start of this meeting. He was last year's champion and now finds himself against Nick Davis. Well, Davis, 36 years of age, heavily involved in the sport. In fact, his crew chief here is his business partner, and the pair of them are heavily involved in drag racing, not just here at the racetrack, but also in their normal workaday lives. Dave Pollen, well, he's a car mechanic and car sprayer. Whoa, they both pull red lights on the tree. My goodness me, haven't seen that for a while. Pollen was the first one away. He gets eliminated, Nick Davis, by virtue of the fact that Pollen pulled the red first, goes through into the final, where we know he will be meeting this man. This weekend's number one qualifier, going every which way but straight, the Rover 800 Coupe of race car builder Andy Gus to his friends Robinson, who just trickles through after that sideways move, 10.66. Well, we get ready for the semi-finals of Pro Stock Bike, and what we've got left here at the moment are all Suzukis. This man, Richard Gipp, knows he's got a mountain to climb here as he finds himself up against the number one qualifier, Paul Willis. These machines are so highly technical. The bodywork is used to channel the air through into the carburetors. They've got off-board starters. You can just see the mechanic, the crew chief, taking that starter away. And that's Richard Gipp looking across to Paul Willis to see if he should start his static burnout. Now, these machines are very, very long, very low. They still bear a passing resemblance to their road-going counterparts, in this case, Suzuki GSXRs. But those long wheelie bars out the back are designed to try and keep that nose wheel on the ground. At a red light, Richard Jett knew he had to get away quickly. He pulls a red light on the tree, automatically hands the win to Paul Willis. Willis, is anyone going to beat him? 7.70, 173 miles per hour. Superb. They sound like a swarm of angry hornets. Lenz Padgett here with the White Lightning Suzuki. Again, based on a GSXR. Light carbon fibre bodywork as a replica of the road-going bike. And he's up against the man who's been doing so well, Chris Hope. Hope breaks on the line. Well, it certainly didn't spring eternal for him, did it? And while all that was happening, Len Padgett went through and took the win, finds himself in the final as Chris Hope pushes away to race another day.
Terry, how's the first meeting of the Super Series going?
Very, very encouraged. We've had tremendous entry this weekend. We've had the weather behind us. The track's been excellent. Everyone's worked very hard. And the greatest thing is seeing lots of people coming through the gate and supporting the races, which has been brilliant.
And obviously the weather is a really important factor, isn't it?
It's a big factor in drag racing, particularly in any country, but especially in England, because if there's a slightest bit of rain or any threat of rain, it tends to put the overcast on racing in general. The track needs to be warm. That gives the cars the chance to put their maximum performance in. And the racer do his ultimate as well.
How's the organisation and administration been ticking over today?
Oh, once again, everyone's working very hard. I mean, as you know, we had the MSA in this weekend to oversee us, to make sure that everything was performing well. I believe they've gone away very happy, and there's a great future for the venue.
Richard, you're one of the clerks of the course. How have things been going at this first Super Series meeting?
So far, very smoothly. We've had the weather with us. Everything's gone very well today. And yes, we're very pleased with the weekend.
What does a clerk of a course do at a drag racing meeting?
He's responsible for the implementation of the rules and for the first port of call if any protests or appeals against those rules.
Are you concerned with safety?
Always concerned with safety. We pride ourselves of having a very high standard here. As you can see, we've got fire crew, ambulances there. They're all trained, and it's something we take very seriously.
What sort of input does the MSA have at drag racing?
They have quite a big input. There is a drag racing subcommittee, and they meet regularly and discuss the rules and regulations and anything else that may come up.
Well, it certainly seems as though everybody has had a good day, right from the racers up to the organisers, as we kick in with our first finals from the 1999 Super Series here at Avon Park Raceway. I love this. We're riding here with Lee Huxley. Well, Huxley is going into the final in his Roadster up against the Ford Mustang of last year's number two man in the championship, Bob Lees from Bristol. Lee Huxley from Worcester. And start line reactions are 0.55 for Lee Huxley, a 0.60 for Bob Lees. So already Lee has made up 0.03 of a second. You just saw the nose of the Mustang come in on the left-hand side. But look at that, a perfect 10.90, 117 miles an hour. Well done to Lee Huxley. We're back with these arm-wrenchingly quick pro stock bikes. This is Paul Willis. His crew chief there is his brother-in-law, Mark Fossey, no mean racer himself. Len Padgett then goes through the burnout on his Suzuki, both riders then on Suzuki's as we come up to the start line. Len knows he's got to try and get a good reaction time away from the start line, and it's a red light. You can see it on the tree. Len Padgett reacted before the green came on. Almost perfect reaction time for Paul Willis. And another 7.7, 173 miles an hour. What a fabulous weekend that young man from Bedworth in Warwickshire has had. Well, these are our big boys today, the stars of our show, the Pro Modifieds, these 200 miles per hour door slammers. These machines never cease to amaze me, and I love these burnouts. The crowd really react well to these big, big smoky burnouts. It's a bit awful if you're sitting inside the car, however. The smell really, it gets into every nook and cranny of your body. It's horrible. Rob Loring there, just making sure that the burnout is completed from the Oldsmobile Cutlass, the Kendall car of Nick Davis. Both of these men from Berkshire. As I said earlier on, Nick heavily involved in drag racing, and of course Andy Robertson builds these cars all the time. Wow, they're away together. Real good start from both of them. A 48 reaction time for Gus Robinson, a 50 for Nick Davis. Close at the top end, but another 680 for Gus Robinson. What a fabulous weekend he's had. He's our Pro Mod winner.
Paul, so consistent. I mean, is this how it's going to be now the rest of the year, or are you going to try and go quicker?
We want to go quicker.
What sort of times do you reckon? I mean, you're 770s now, like it's clockwork. I mean, what sort of times are you aiming for?
750s and then 740s, we hope.
Really?
Yeah.
How does it feel today?
Real good.
Yeah, I bet.
Really good.
Yeah, good.
It's a good weekend.
You enjoy it all?
Yeah, we didn't hurt any bits.
Wonderful.
So it was real good.
Well, that was good for you today, wasn't it?
Absolutely superb, yeah. The car was going great. We were reacting good. Everything just came together at the end, and it was brilliant, yeah.
Now, what are you going to do? Because you share the driving in this thing with your old man, and he's getting on a bit now, isn't he? Let's be fair. I mean, he doesn't cut it anymore, does he?
I don't know. He's as good a driver as me, and, you know, we will keep it 50-50, and it puts the pressure on. There's a bit of competition between us both, so... You know, that adds to it, and it's great. I mean, if it weren't for him and the team and my family and everybody, you know, I wouldn't be able to do it, so he'd be on his own. So, no, it's great that we do it together, and we really get on well, and it's brilliant.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed our first introduction to the Super Series in 1999 here from Avon Park. 2 weeks' time, we'll be meeting these, the youngsters in this new class, the junior dragsters, powered there by Lawnmower, right the way up to these machines, the top alcohol teams. It's going to be absolutely fantastic. Don't miss it. We'll see you then. We're back at Avon Park Raceway for our second look at the first round of the 1999 Super Series. If you didn't see our first programme, glorious weather surrounded the proceedings here in Warwickshire. And we'll be looking at these young possible stars of the future in this programme, plus two of our super classes, Super Comp and Super Gas, and also venturing into the world and cooking up a storm with our top alcohol teams. First of all, though, into the Super Gas pits, and major problems for the driver of this little Chevrolet Monza. That's last year's champion from Newcastle upon Tyne, Frank Mason. Let's hear from him on what's happening.
Well, Frank, what a comeback here to defend your championship. Things certainly, if they go wrong in drag racing, they go wrong in a big way, don't they?
Yeah. It's you can do some serious damage, you know, because I really have to get some power out of these engines, you know, so yeah, they're quite highly stressed, so occasionally they go pop.
And what went pop on yours?
I dropped the valve and damaged the piston and cracked the bore as well, so it was really not... too serious to fix on the track, really.
Well, we welcome to Avon Park Raceway the second round of the MSA Top Alcohol Championship. Let's have a word with our foreign competitor, Lex June.
Lex, it's great to see you here, as always, in the British Championship, the man from Holland.
Yes, it's nice to be here. Great place, nice people, so why not?
Good. Now, how is the car running? Because you're number three qualifier. I mean, we only have four cars here for this second round of the British Championship. You're number three qualifier. How is the car operating?
Well, we try to get a setup to run the car. The problem is the track is green, so there's not much rubber. So it's looking for traction, especially with a bigger engine. We have more power, so it's harder to get the traction, but we managed to do one good pass yesterday and we go from there.
Okay, we move into the semi-finals of Supergas. We've got Sean Saunders against Brendan Clancy. That's a Z car, Datsun Z car against a Chevrolet Nova. And another Chevrolet Nova in the hands of Scotland's Luke Ramage against Scotland's Jim McGee. And that's what we're going to be turning our attention to as Jim goes through the burnout, all designed to heat up the compound in those big rear slicks. And what do you do if you heat up rubber? It all becomes very, very tacky and should give you good traction away from the start line. These cars produce in Supergas around about 600 horsepower, so you need a good set of sticky boots at the back to get all that power down. And a 0.48 reaction time for the Chevy Nova and Luke Ramage. That may tell at the top end. It was a 59 reaction time for Jim McGee as they head towards the top end. 9.96 plays 9.96. That was one on the start line by Luke Ramage. Great race between those two. As we move into the other semi-final, the Datsun Z car of Hickstead's Sean Saunders. plays the black Chevrolet Nova of Brendan Clancy. Big family outing for the Clancy family. They're all involved with this beautiful car. Now this game is going to be won and lost on the start line. When you get to Super Gas at this level, they need to react as close to that 0.40 as they can, and then to run the 990s. Here we go. Oh, Brendan just couldn't hold the car on the start line. He goes before the green came on, automatically hands the win to Sean Saunders. Sean Saunders will be meeting Luke Ramage in the final. He breaks out on that run. It doesn't matter, 9.86. We move into the 890 class now and the Super Comps. And the first of our semi-finals puts John Webster with his Roadster against Zane Llewellyn from Bristol with his Dragster. There it is. Now, the Bristol Door Slammers are responsible for Zane Llewellyn and this car. They paint everything of theirs black. While they're away together, well, two experienced drag racers here. John Webster in the Roadster. His reaction time of 43. Zane Llewellyn was a 42. As they head towards the top end, they look for 8.9. He does it again. Webster, 8.95. 3 days hard racing. Give us our finals in the classes that we've been following in our program. Starting off, of course, with these beautiful little cars, the Junior Dragsters. Interesting scenario here. The only girl currently racing, that's young Miss Gibbs, Katie Gibbs, in the stock dragster, finds herself up against Paul Allen in the modified dragster. So to even them up, there's a handicap against the modified car. Katie Gibbs has got to react well here and get as far up the track as she can. There she goes. Reaction time for Katie was a 0.61. And she's away in her little 5-horsepower dragster. And there we are, Paul Allen is off chasing. His reaction time was a lot worse than the girl, let me tell you, at 0.99. Is it going to be a girl power final? It is indeed. Katie Gibbs takes the win. Well done to her, 16.21. Lose out was a 9.53. And that was all done on indexes. But well done, our first junior dragster winner at Avon Park is Katie Gibbs. Into the final of the 990 class then. This is Super Gas, and we put the Z car, the Datsun Z car of Sean Saunders, up against Glasgow's Luke Ramage. Now, really, these guys are so professional. This is going to be won and lost, I'm sure, on the start line. So we're going to be looking for electric 0.40 reaction times from these two. Here we go, moving up into the staging beam. We're looking for 0.40. They move forward into one staging beam called pre-stage, then another 8 inches into full stage. Oh, an almost identical reaction time, but a better, slightly better reaction time for Luke Ramage, a 0.41 to a 0.45. So already Sean is chasing. They get to the top end, 9.92, takes the win over a 9.93. Excellent Super Gas racing. That's what the class is all about. Well done, Luke Ramage. Well, the final of Supercomp puts the two beautiful Alterns against one another. This is a photographer's paradise with these two cars coming out together. All of our trackside photographers from all of the media have suddenly taken it upon themselves to stand up and start taking photographs of these two beautiful cars. Tim Adam in the orange machine, John Webster in the yellow and silver machine. If you remember back to the semi-finals, they're running almost identical times. This really is going to be a very, very tight final indeed between these two. Let's see how we get on. Again, they're going to be looking for 0.4 reaction times. And it's a 43 to John Webster and a 45 to Tim Adam. That could be all important at the top end. They're side by side. Who's going to get there? Tim Adam gets there first, but breaks out. And look at the time for John Webster. Right on that index, 8.90, 148 miles per hour. Well, what is this man doing? He's just checking the temperature of the ground. He wasn't trying to communicate with somebody underneath it, because it's the final of Top Alcohol. Remember, it's the second round of the National MSA Championship. And our major problem here in this final is that we only have one finalist. If you remember in the interview with Dave Wilson, he was very, very reluctant to confirm he was going to come out in the final. And indeed, when his crew, Barry Redstone and Bob Gledow, worked so hard along with the man himself, they just couldn't get the dragster ready. So it's going to be the Flying Dutchman himself in his Dutch Spirit car completely on his own in the final. And this man really is an entertainer. It's going to be interesting to see what sort of a burnout we get from this man. Though he looks very, very sort of fed up and glum there. Once he gets behind the wheel of this car, his whole character changes. So the crew are ready. There's an off-board electric starter. They've just connected that up to the battery, poured in some petrol into the bug catcher, and that gulps in the air to feed the supercharger, and that pressures this engine up. Some say these alcohol engines now produce somewhere in the region of 3,000 horsepower, but it's very, very difficult to measure this type of power. Twin magnetos on the car as this hinged at the back body gets latched down. Valvoline are the sponsors. And we look from the inside of Lex June's car. I think we've put an onboard camera in with the Dutchman. Let's have a look and see as we head towards the start line to go with the burnout. Beautifully swoopy body, that big aero deck on the back, designed to keep downforce on those two big slicks. So just revs it, goes for the burnout. And this is Lex June's signature tune, a big, big smoky burnout. And there we are. You can see what it's like inside. All of that smoke when you're doing those burnouts wafts inside the car, and it really gets up your nose. It's a horrible, horrible smell. And you have to open the escape hatch. Now, this is, if there was something awful to happen to this car, this will be the driver's only way out of this car. It's his little escape hatch. He'd quick release on his harness and come out through the top. He can't lift this bodywork off on his own. So here we go, Lex June reversing the car up. And he is allowed, although he comes from the Netherlands, he's allowed, due to the fact that we belong to the good old European Economic Community, he is allowed to take part in championships inside the UK. Now, the man who's currently leading the championship, Peter Beck from Switzerland, is not here at this meeting. So everybody is going to benefit from that fact. And Lex June especially will benefit because, of course, he is going to take all the winning points. So we'll have to have a look at the end of this particular run and see how the championship is looking. But here we go, after that storming burnout. It's a big crowd here at Avon Park for the first Super Series in 1999. So Lex wanted to come out and entertain everybody that was here. And he has previously run a personal best of 6.01 in this car. So let's see how he's going to get on. A solo final to bring our day's racing here at Avon Park to a close. Moving up to the staging beams, waiting for that green to come on. The lights will burn down. He'll still be looking for a 0.40 reaction time, but he's under no threat here. Reacts with a 0.77 and powers through the quarter mile. Out comes the chute, 6.20, 226 miles per hour. That's our winner. And here he is at the end of the quarter mile, just taking off the neck brace. And happy in the knowledge that he's moved up from fourth spot in the national championship to third spot. After this weekend's event, Rob Turner now leads the MSA championship with 175 points. Then Dave Wilson, 173. Then Lex June, 172.
Well, that's it from us. Great racing all the way through the weekend here at Avon Park. That's the end of Super Series number one in the year 1999. It's now in the can. Come back in June and see us for the number two event here at Avon Park Raceway.
Okay, well, welcome to our second program here, the Panasonic Super Series number two from Avon Park Raceway. We're in Warwickshire, the sun's out again. Super Series seems to attract the beautiful sunshine here. It's a bit blustery, but that isn't going to bother me so much. But I don't know if I would be bothered if I would be on one of these machines. This is what we're going to be looking at in part of our program, Top Fuel Motorcycle. I'm sitting astride a machine here which has the capability to run the quarter mile in 6.5 seconds, well in excess of 200 miles an hour. Now for me, this is complete and utter madness. This is the last thing on earth I'd ever want to get my leg over.
Well, besides Top Fuel bike, let's have a look at some of the other regular classes that we'll be meeting, like Pro Modified Car, Super Street Car, etc. But before we get into all of that, let's have a word with the man who's currently leading the Pro Modified Championship.
It always amazes me when I come along here to Avon Park, because one minute you're all over the place, you're not running really well at all, and the next minute you're suddenly the number one qualifier. How on earth do you do these quite incredible changes to the car to make you get down the track so quickly? Because you are number one this weekend.
Yeah, well, it's a clutch change, John. We went out on the first pass, and after Nick put a really stout pass in, that 77 was awesome, really, really good. And we just shook, but our clutch trace showed us that our clutch tune was close, but not quite right. So that allowed us then for the second pass to adjust our clutch and make the good pass.
Number three qualifier, you're in the 699 you ran. How quick have you been on this bike?
673 at Santa Pod last year.
Really? So why is it not running 670s this year?
Over the winter, we filled it a lot of re-engineering. You put a new blower, new manifolding, there's a new mags, there's a lot of new parts on, and we're still feeling our way down step by step.
Well, just listen to the cackle of these power plants. They sound absolutely superb. What you've got to remember here is we're looking at nitromethane as a fuel, which is an explosive. Huge smoky burnout. Brian Johnson's bike, BJ we call him in drag racing, really sounding fierce. They produce somewhere around about 1,000 horsepower per machine. Just think about that. You're sitting astride something with all that power. You hardly steer these bikes. What you do is you lean them to keep them on the straight and narrow. And BJ is our number one qualifier here this weekend, right down into the mid-60s. He goes there again. 6.51, 189 miles an hour. Ian King was in the opposing lane. A great run for him. Loses out with a 7.19 at 193. Closest to the camera is Chris Hampson. Now, until this year, we've always seen Chris on a funny bike. In the opposing lane, Steve Woollett. Woollett goes up in smoke. Well, this is going to be a turnaround. Chris Hampson runs 6.79, 199 miles an hour. Wow, the action. I've got to go and sit in a dark room. OK, we move into the big boys, the pro-modified cars, and the man currently leading the championship, the race car builder. This is Andy Robinson with the Rover 800 Coupe. Finds himself up against an ever-improving Al Cook from Liverpool in that split-window Corvette. Well, reaction time, excellent. A 0.46 for Al Cook, a 49 for Gus. Gus Robinson running through, takes the win. And that's the wing come off of the back of Gus's car. Wow. But everything OK, the parachutes are out. The marshal retrieves the wing. 6.75 for Gus Robinson. And everybody else just watching what's going on the start line. This is Nick Davis. Look at that cabin there. Doesn't it look busy? Rob Loring shuts the door. Nick Davis finds himself up against the Camaro of Gordon Appleton. Both of these guys running in the sixes here this weekend. This could be anybody's race. Gordon pulls a red light. He automatically hands the win to Nick Davis. The Kendall-sponsored car goes through into the final and we'll be meeting Andy Robinson. We're in the semi-finals now of Super Street, and it's interesting that the three semi-finalists that we've got here are the numbers one, two, and three men in this year's Super Series Super Street Championship. Bob Lees in that blue Mustang is in the number two spot, and Huxley in the Ford Roadster, closest to the camera, is in the number one spot at the moment. And almost identical reaction times for these two as they head towards the finish line. Who takes the win? It's a battle of the breakouts. It was Lee Huxley who broke out the least and took the win with a 10.85. Lee Morris, he's on a bye run. I love E-type Jaguars, you know. I should have been a child of the 60s. I'm thinking about it. I think I was. This has got a 3.8 XK Jaguar engine underneath the hood. Let's see how he gets on. Looking for 10.9. 10.91. Hey, he wants to win this weekend. Well, we're going to pick up on some highlights now from Super Street Bike again. We saw their first round, and we're into the semi-finals now. David Brown, closest to the camera, finds himself up against our number one qualifier. Now, at this point in time, we're running over the eighth only. It's been judged that the wind is too severe here, so we have to let the bikes, these bikes, run over the eighth mile. Graham Dance, he's a man we've been following throughout this particular event. Let's see how he gets on against the championship leader, Dave Holland. And he takes the win, Graham Dance, 5.65 over the eighth mile. And with that, Graham went on to win the Super Street Bike event in the final. Dave Holland not picking up maximum points this time around. OK, well, we're into all of our finals now. And the first one we're going to be looking at are the Super Street cars, the 1090 class. And here we are. The Ford Roadster plays the E-Type Jaguar. What a mix of vehicles we get in this Super Series. And we're riding with the championship leader. This is Lee Huxley. Now, let's see if we can see that E-Type Jaguar sting his nose in front as we go up the quarter mile. Certainly at the moment, it's the first one, don't forget, who reaches the top and it doesn't go quicker than 10.90. There's Lee Huxley across the start line. There's the Jag. And it was Lee Huxley who got the win, 11.04 to 11.06. Great close racing. It's the 890 class now. John Webster with the Brogy Roadster comes up against Zane Llewellyn from Bristol in his black dragster. The Bristol boys paint all their cars black. John Webster from Higham Ferries in the opposing lane. This is going to be tight, and it is tight indeed. They both react with a 0.41. It was a 4.10 for John, a 4.18 for Zane. Hey, who's going to win here? It's the battle of the breakout. Look. Just John Webster takes that by 1/100th of a second. More points for him. This is Ray Simpson. Crew chief for this man, Andy Gus Robinson. It's the final of Pro Modified and puts the Rover 800 Coupe up against Nick Davis in the Oldsmobile Cutlass. So the crew just waiting for Nick to get ready for the burnout in the opposing lane. Big, big smoky burnout. And in the opposing lane, Nick has done his burnout. Rob Loring just letting all that tyre smoke out of the inside of the car, just priming the nitrous oxide injection. This is going to be real, real interesting. Again, we've got two cars here this weekend running down into the 6-second bracket, but Gus Robinson in that Rover is so very, very fast, just venting the nitrous oxide system as they come up to the start line. This could be anybody's. As we go into stage, start line reactions almost identical here. And Nick Davis fighting for control. And there's that wing. The wing is off. Oh, my God, look at this. The car is over. It seems to have stopped, but then it's rolling again. Gus Robinson rolling and rolling and rolling. There's nothing left of that car. My goodness me. First man on the scene, Nick Davis in the Oldsmobile Cutlass. Well, still in the car at this moment in time is Gus Robinson. Now, let's just see what happens here. Nick is out. Nick is running. It's his friend in the car. Oh, this always turns my stomach when this sort of thing happens. And just waiting for all the rescue services to get there. They're on the spot real, real quick. And Nick dives into the car. Let's just watch this again. Both of these guys experiencing problems here with handling. You can see Nick going every which way but straight. But at this point in time, Gus has got it covered. He was a good reaction time of 42 to a 50. But then that wing comes off, that offloads the pressure on those rear tires. And from that moment on, the car is in control. No longer is Gus Robinson in control of that car. And the replica body of that Rover 800 being destroyed by this roll. It seemed at one point there that the car had come to a standstill, but then continues to roll on. My goodness me. There'll be no more driving from that car and ends up on its roof. Well, quite extraordinary. And he took the win with a 6.69, 210 miles an hour when all that happened. He's perfectly okay, being led back to the ambulance with two black eyes.
So, Lee, a second win, that onboard camera's really bringing you some luck, isn't it?
Yeah, that seems to be working. I think we'll have to have that right through the Super Series. The car's coming good when it needs to. We're doing everything right. We're having a bit of luck as well, which helps. And yeah, everything's going great. The car's coming good when it needs to. We're doing everything right. We're having a bit of luck as well, which helps. And yeah, everything's going great.
Well, what can I say to you? Long-time friend, well done. A great win.
Thank you, John. Feels great.
You're really pumped up on that, aren't you?
I am, yeah. You should have seen me down the end of the track, mate.
Really happy?
Yeah, absolutely. Avon Park's always been good to me, you know? I'll always do well here. The other tracks, you know, tend to have problems, but here, it's real good.
Consistency is a byword in your house, isn't it?
Seems to be at the moment, yeah. I think it's more luck than anything, to be honest.
I don't believe, hey, come on, I do not believe that. You're running 891, 892, 893. You're pulling them out all the time. Plus, of course, electric start line reactions.
Yeah, well, I guess it's the car, really. I mean, we built the car last year. It's been purposely built for the class, and we couldn't ask any more from it, really. I think if I lose, it's going to be my fault, definitely, because the car is consistent and it reacts so good. So Yeah, I put it down to the car personally. I think any good driver in the class could drive the car and be competitively placed in the championship.
Well, with that massive crash there from Andy Robinson, that brings us to the end of Super Series number two. Andy's being airlifted away to hospital perfectly okay. Just proves how well these drag racing cars are built. And welcome back to Stratford-on-Avon in Warwickshire for our second look at the second round of the Panasonic Super Series for 1999. In this particular programme, we'll be following three classes, the 990 Warriors, the Super Gassers, our first ever look at the Super Pro class, the quickest of all the ET brackets, and a look at Pro Stock Bike, where the action is now really hotting up. 1999 saw the introduction of the new 4-valve 1500cc engines, and the times are coming a-tumbling down. Let's have a word with the number one qualifier.
Paul, winner Pro Stock Bike, first round of the Super Series. How's it been going this weekend so far?
Pretty good. We've had a few problems with just traction off the start line. Apart from that, everything's looking pretty good. We ran our best speed we've ever ran, which we're real pleased with. There's a new British record at 175, so we're real pleased with that and hoping to go a bit better today.
Qualify first?
Yeah, 7.64, which we know we can go a bit quicker than that, so we're quite pleased with that.
And you've equaled the track record here, I understand?
Yes, yeah, we ran 7.64 at the last meeting as well, so we're sure we can go a bit quicker today.
Well, Paul Willis hasn't got it all completely his own way. Back in the frame again for good times is Dave Beck from Nantwich in Cheshire.
Dave, qualified second today. Everything gone to plan?
Not really. We were expecting to get three qualifying sessions, not two. It's a brand new engine. We've never run it before, and just easing up on it steadily, really.
Is that yesterday's weather causing problems?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, we lost a bit of downtime, with a bit of a rain shower, and that just put everything back a bit. So, we lost a final session that we could have done with.
Well, in the 990 class, Supergas, the man currently leading not only the Super Series, but the National Championship, is Scotland's Luke Ramage.
Luke Ramage, first last time in Supergas. Can you do it again?
Well, we're hoping to do it, yeah. We had problems yesterday with the car. First time we ran out with tyre spin at the start line, we ran a 10-0. The second time we ran a 987. We had a wee bit of tailwind with the car, and that was why we had broken out. So we just need to wait and see how we go on today, but hopefully we can do it. Feeling confident.
How's the engine been holding up? All right.
Well, the engine's been fine. Performance Unlimited is the guy who builds the engine, and pretty confident with that. The engine's been great, no problems at all. It's pretty consistent. I think we've seen the last time we were running like 143.77 in the first run and 143.77. So it's a pretty good indication that the engine's making good power and it's doing everything it should be doing.
Well, we welcome Super Pro, bracket racing class, to our TV programme. This is the class where the drivers set their own handicapping times. Let's talk to Wayne Saunders, who owns this Pro. This quite exquisite motor car, just describe the car first of all to me.
Well, what it is basically, it's a Ford Pro bodied. It's 106-inch wheelbase, chrome moly chassis. We use a Ford 2.1-litre engine. It's a BDTE, which is an evolution engine of the old BD series engine. Comes from the RS200 rally car, produces around about 900 brake horsepower. We use a billet two-plate clutch, a five-speed Liberty air-shifted gearbox, and the whole combination works pretty well. It runs mid-sevens. We're currently the fastest four-cylinder car in the world, and we're having great fun with it.
There are some big plans, I hear, for you for the millennium year. Are you allowed to give us, I know Ford, the name Ford is involved in it somewhere, are you allowed to give us any details of that?
Yeah, sure. Basically what's happened, I've been given the opportunity to produce a test car for Ford in the shape of a Ford Focus, which is just about to be launched in America, and that we've been asked if we could produce the car and take it to America and just to gain some publicity for them. Using the engine and gearbox combination out of the Pro, we're going to build a brand new chassis, brand new body, and just solely for publicity for the Focus. Not necessarily to achieve any great records or anything, but just to show the Americans that four cylinders is an alternative to V8 racing, and we just hope that we can do a good job for them.
Okay, we move on to Pro Stock Bike, and this is going to be real tight here. Len Paget plays Paul Willis. Len was the number four qualifier, Paul the number one. But already we're seeing Len Paget. He has excellent start line reactions. We're watching him down into the sevens, and he reacts from the 43 to a 53. So he's made up a tenth of a second on Paul Willis already. But the power of Willis's Suzuki comes back. Hey, 7.64, 173 miles an hour. My goodness me, that boy is almost unstoppable. Well, here's our number two qualifier. This is the farmer from Nantwich in Cheshire. This is Dave Beck on his Suzuki. All these guys at the top of this particular class using derivatives of the Suzuki GSXR. Very long, very, very low, all designed to help the airflow past these machines. Richard Gipp is in the opposing lane, and Richard pulls a better start line reaction. A 53 to a 69. Is there going to be an upset here? No, Dave Beck takes the win, finds himself in the final against Paul Willis with that run of 7.78. We're back with Super Pro once more. The Ampar car of Steve Green on a bye run through into the final. He dials in 8.75. Let's see how close he can run. If he goes underneath it on a bye run, he won't be eliminated. It doesn't matter, and he does just that. 8.69, 154 miles per hour as we turn our attention to Wayne Saunders and Mark Flavel. And a real mix of cars. This beautiful probe, we've been hearing about all the exciting news from that man in connection with Fords. And he's up against Mark Flavel. 8.20 is the darling for him. 7.60 was the darling for Wayne Saunders, but he throws it all the way. He couldn't hold the probe on the start line. He pulls a red light. And Mark Flavel is in the final against Steve Green. Super Gas. Once more, Frank Mason is having a great weekend. At the last event here, he broke his motor in a big, big way. This weekend, he's back with a vengeance. Previous Super Gas champion up against Spencer Tram. Both of them in the 0.4 reaction, a 45 for Spencer, a 48 for Frank. Now then, again, who's going to cross the finish line first? Frank does it. 9.92 puts Spencer on the trailer. And this is Peter Lane from Surrey with his white Camaro. Started the season off good on the National Championship, but then didn't do so well here at Avon Park. And now coming back with a vengeance, runs through 9.89, which sets up the final in Super Gas, which will be Peter Lane against Frank Mason in Pro Stock Bike, Paul Willis against Dave Beck, and Mark Flavel against Steve Green. They'll be looking for the honours in Super Pro. Well, a lot of attention there on the two finalists in Pro Stock Bike. Now, these were the times these guys were promising us all the way through 1998. 1999 is here, and we're getting them. That's Ian Dales, just giving Dave Beck the customary pat on the back as he brings his charge up to the start line. And again, 0.40 is a perfect start line reaction in Pro Stock Bike. And they're almost together. A 0.480 reaction time for Paul Willis. A 0.489 for Dave Beck. His can be anybody's. Paul Willis takes it. Look at that, a 761 to a 775. Great drag race, well done. The final of Super Gas. Great to see Frank Mason. You have to appreciate I'm the same age as Frank, and I like it when the oldies sock it to the youngsters. So Frank Mason back there in that Chevrolet Monza up against Pete Lane in his Chevrolet Camaro. Again, start line reactions all important, and Frankie gets the better one, 0.46 for him. Peter Lane, 0.53. Now then, 9.9 we're looking for. Frank is the one who breaks out by the least, 9.87 to a 9.84. Frank Mason takes the win and gets some well-earned points in the Super Series Championship. Well, here we go, Steve Green then, in this Mark 1 Cortina. This, in actual fact, is the second car of this design that Steve Green has had. This is a purpose-built race car. His first Mark 1 Cortina was a road-going Mark 1, which he got racing right down into the 8-second bracket. Quite phenomenal. But up here against Mark Flavel, Mark Flavel dials in 8.2. Steve Green dials in 8.7. So the handicap against the dragsters. We watch the lights burn down. And a great star line reaction there for Steve Green. Mark Flavel in chase mode. I don't think he's going to do it as long as Steve Green doesn't break out. He dialed in 8.7. He knows that car. 8.73. He takes the win. Let's have a word with the winner of Supergas.
Frank, after the disappointment last time, great. You've come out. You've had a win. Excellent.
Yes, I was really pleased to do that. We did it the hard way as well, I suppose, and because we weren't very lucky in the pairings. We never had any buys or anything, so I had a fight all the way. I know some close fights out there today, so I really enjoyed it, yeah.
How do you feel the car setup was?
We thought it was very good. This engine's so good, it wants to rev all the time. I have trouble slowing it down, actually, so it's a bit of a worry all the time because you think it's going to over-rev, but at the same time you're racing, so you have to take these chances, you know.
Steve Green, you didn't have too good a trot at the first round of the Super Series, but you've come good this time.
Yeah, this has been a really good day for us. This is the furthest we've been with this car since I've built it. This is the first win we've had with this car in nearly 3 years, so it's a really good day.
How is it handling? How's the engine holding up?
It's fine. It handles, the faster it goes, the better it handles. And the track's really good today. And the engine, with the stage of tune we've got into the engine at the moment, we just come back and put some fuel in and we go race again. So that's very good.
Well, here we are back at Avon Park for round three of the Panasonic Air Conditioning Super Series. So much action. The one thing about Avon Park that's proved it in 1999, every time we come along here for the Super Series, the weather is superb. It has been absolutely sunshine and beach weather here this weekend, and the action has been as hot to match. Let's have a look at what's been going on. Well, some of the action has rather been destroyed by this hot weather. It has been so warm. The guys and the girls have been working real, real hard to get their equipment working properly, but the weather, being so hot, hasn't aided the internal combustion engine. It's one of those strange things in drag racing. But the pits are full of action. There's a big field here this weekend, and in our programme, we're going to be looking at Supergas. This is a current championship contender, Peter Lane with the ear-split Loudenboomer car. We're going to be looking at Super Street, Green with Envy, the E-Type Jaguar, just making its way up to the top. And we're also going to be looking at not bikes of that size, but bikes of this size. This is Top Fuel Bike. This is their second visit to us here at Avon Park. And these machines have the capability of running the quarter mile, 200 miles an hour in 6 seconds. Here is the number one qualifier, Steve Woollett.
Steve, congratulations. Number one qualifier. How's that make you feel this weekend?
Yeah, it's pretty good. We're leading the championship going into this final round, so it's a good position to be in number one.
So you stand, if you go through to the final today, you stand a chance of winning the championship?
Oh, I believe so, yeah.
Hey, that's pretty good. Tell me, how does this hot weather affect Top Fuel motorcycles?
They're pretty asthmatic. When the old air is like this, it's very thin. But to put more nitro in, compensate for it.
Here's the man who's number three in the 1090 Super Street Class Championship.
Lee, you qualified third yesterday. Things are going okay?
Things are going fine, yes. We're ready this morning for any action that's put in front of us.
You came runner-up last time to Lee Huxley, and he won the first two rounds of the Super Series. Do you think you can beat him this time?
I think he was jammy last time, yeah. If you look at his car, his wheels stick out the front. And I've told him about it, and we've had a bit of a joke. And it just looks like you're in front and his wheels are sticking out, so it's a slightly odd shaped car, so I'm ready for that next time.
From an E-Type Jaguar to an American Camaro, this is now Supergas, the 990 class. This is the man currently leading the championship, Surrey's Peter Lane.
Pete, hey, listen, you're leading the championship with Frankie Mason and seemingly doing very, very well. How long have you been around the sport now, Pete?
On and off for, what's it got to be, 25 years.
My goodness me, so you're quite an old stager at this.
72 first came to drag racing.
But you seem to have settled into Supergas so nice and comfortably.
It's a great class. Everybody's so friendly, it's really competitive. It's one of the best classes to be in, so why move?
Well, we do spot one or two of our drivers pulling the front wheels up every now and again in the sport. That's because they produce so much power, but not quite in the way that this machine does it. This is Alan Herridge in the jointly owned Stingray. He owns this with famous drag racing man Ronnie Picardo. And this car was originally built, would you believe, in 1967 by the then promoter at Santaport, Roy Phelps. It's been updated by Ronnie Picardo and Alan Herridge. And this is what you get all the way through to the quarter mile, just on the back wheels on its own. The man from Garston, Steve Woollett, has been around drag racing for well in excess of 20 years now. He knows these top fuel bikes inside out. Just getting himself ready to go. Running these machines on nitro methane, a Puma 1327cc power plant. It's called the dealer. Somebody thinks they spotted a problem. Steve said, no, there is no problem there at all. We're okay. You can see the lariat, which connects Steve to the cutoff, the automatic cutoff on that bike. If he was to come adrift from the bike, he pulls the lariat and immediately the engine shuts down. So here we come, putting the fuel up onto high side now. It looks so uncomfortable on these bikes. See the peg right at the back, and immediately he's away from the start line. His feet are on the peg. He steers it literally by leaning left, leaning right, transfers of body weight. Hey, look at this, 6.70, 199 miles per hour. This man is looking for the championship. Have you ever seen a bike like this? It looks as though it's come from a futuristic film, doesn't it? This is Ian King. He is Drag Racing's ACU representative. And this machine used to be campaigned by Phil Brackvogel. Now in a new colour scheme, now with a new rider on board. And Ian King is doing very, very well indeed. He was our number two qualifier here this weekend with a 6.83. Gets a little bit out of shape at the top end, but 6.94, 198 miles per hour. That sets up our final, Woollett against King. Well, here's our first pair, Craig Gibbs. I wouldn't like to put money on either of these two. They're both excellent on the start line, and they're both real, real cute at running the quarter mile at 9.9 seconds. John Webster looking across out of his Brogy Roadster just to see what's going on with Craig Gibbs in his Panasonic Camaro. Now then, Craig knows, another man who knows, he pulls a red light. Craig Gibbs goes out, he knew. He's up against the master tactician on the start line of John Webster. He knew he had to pull a good light. He runs an almost perfect 9.94. John Webster breaks out, but it doesn't matter. John Webster had been given the win by courtesy of that red light on the start line. What a great, great shame for Craig Gibbs. Well, here's the man who could now be heading towards the top of the Super Gas Championship, Luke Ramage. But he meets the number one qualifier here this weekend. That's Bristol's Conrad Stanley, and they look as though they're away together. It's going to be the first one to the top end. It doesn't go quicker than 10.9. Who gets it? Luke Ramage gets it. 9.98 to a 10.05 lose out. Hey, great racing. Okay, we're into the semi-finals then of Super Streetcar, the 1090 class. Interesting, the three guys that are left, Lee Huxley, Bob Lees, Lee Morris, are the numbers 1, 2 and 3 in the Super Series Championship. I wonder whether things could be changing. The man in that black roadster, Lee Huxley, has got a lot of points. He's well out in front, even if he loses here. But we're with Bob Lees, who's well out in front in this particular race. It looks as though it's going to be Lees going very quickly for 10.90. Back of the breakouts. Lees takes the win, 10.85. Our riders getting ready then for the final of Top Fuel Bike. This is Ian King. He's up against Steve Woollett in the final. And it's interesting, we're running two championships here this weekend. The ACU Championship and the Super Series Top Fuel Bike Championship. And the winner of this particular tussle here could actually win the championship. Steve Woollett is the man in the opposing lane, up against Ian King. Both of these guys, 1327 Puma power plant, running on nitro methane, and it looks as though Woollett has it. He'll be getting the championship laurels. He takes the win, 6.77, just under 200 miles per hour. John, what's it been like driving in two classes this weekend? Is it as busy as it looks?
It's getting busy now, yeah. In qualifying that was easy, but now we're getting into eliminations and having come round for the rounds all the time. It's quite interesting.
Well, you're in the final of Supercomp, and this is the semi-final of Super Gas, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. We've got a hot lap. We've got to come back round for the final of Supercomp straight after this run. And then, fortunately, if we can get through this round of Super Gas, then we'll have the final of Super Gas after the Supercomp final. So, fingers crossed, we'll be round another two times yet.
Will the engine stand that, though, John?
The temperature and the engine, oil pressure is fine. It's really behaving itself. We're real happy. Touch wood, it'll stay that way.
How nervous are you?
Very.
This is, you know, you're looking for points now. You were in third spot in the championship here, and you look as though you're on the climb back again. So this really is a tense time for you. Would you rather I wasn't here?
No, it doesn't bother me at all. The adrenaline's pumping out anyway, and it's not going to make any difference whether we're doing this or whether we're sitting here ready to stage.
You've had a great weekend, haven't you, Luke?
I've thoroughly enjoyed the weekend. It's been great. The weather, the track, everything's been good this weekend.
Okay, into the final, would you believe, of Supergas. It's not that we've missed the semi-finals. It was just that when John Webster went to run Richie Smith in the semi-finals, Richie couldn't hold his car on the start line. So as Luke was on a bye run, they decided just to come straight out and run the final now. So here we go. The man from Scotland, Luke Ramage, the man looking for points in this particular round of the championship. If he wins this, I'm certain he is going to move to the top of our Super Series Supergas Championship. And look at these start line reactions, absolutely electric. As they head towards the top end, it could be absolutely anybody's race. Who gets it? Luke Ramage gets it. John Webster breaks out. My goodness me, that's a turn up for the books. So Luke Ramage is going to be very, very happy. Bob Lees and Lee Morris. Mustang against E-Type Jaguar for the points in the Super Street class, the 1090 class. Nuneaton in Warwickshire plays this man, Bristol's Bob Lees, in his big block powered Ford Mustang. Going through the burnout, as they all do, shaking the car. Lee Morris just winding up the E-Type. Well, again, this could be very, very helpful to either one of these two in the championship. Currently, Bob Lees is in second spot in the 1090 championship. Lee Morris is in third spot, and that could all change round depending on who wins here. As we head towards the top end, it's Lee Morris who takes the win. Oh, look at that. Bob Lees breaks out by 0.02 of a second. How happy are you on a scale of 1 to 10, Lee?
10.5, I'd say.
A great run. I mean, it was a very tight final.
It was very tight, yeah. I knew it would be before, but we knew we'd got to pull the stops out for that run. Bob was very unlucky to lose that. He was so close on it.
Yeah, I thought that. I mean, I couldn't have picked a winner, even when you were just about to go across the finish line. I mean, what were you doing? Were you looking out the side of your eyes to see him there?
Well, I could see him. He was in front of me all the way up, and I knew it was fast. So I just eased off at the top, and if Bob eased off as well, he must have knew it was fast as well, and he didn't ease off enough.
Well, we saw his brake lights come on, let me tell you, a good way before the finish line.
Yeah.
And he must have been standing on the brakes, I think. He must have realised he was going too quick.
Know. Maybe he needs his brakes looking at.
Well, welcome back to Avon Park in Stratford-on-Avon. We're going to be seeing the Super Series number 3, loads of explosive drag racing action and some real high stepping stuff as well. These guys get the front wheels right up in the air. Let's go and see who's here.
Well, this weekend it's points make prizes time. Of course, we're in round 3 of the 1999 Super Series, and people trying hard are going to be the pro modifieds in this program. Dave Pollen here, last year's champion, looking for some points to get him back in contention in 1999. And in pro stock bike, Paul Willis, look at the concentration here. He's out in front of the championship at the moment, but there are one or two people who can get close to him this weekend. And Supercomp. Well, Supercomp are the 890 class. The whole idea of Supercomp racing is you try to beat your opponent to the top end of the track, but not go any quicker than 8.9 seconds. And it really has started to become one of the most colourful classes to be seen. There are some absolutely superb looking machines in the class. Well, let's move back to Pro Modified. And one of the cars that really has created a stir in 1999 has been the Corvette Stingray, newly imported from America by Liverpool's Al Cook. Well, it's a long, hard learning process for Al driving this all-new machine. Let's hear from him.
As you know, John, we've had some electrical problems with the car for the first half of the year. And we think we've finally resolved that now. The whole car's been rewired. The car made some serious power for the first time yesterday.
What do you mean, serious power? Just to describe that to me. How do you mean, serious power?
Because of the electrical problems we've had with the car, it's not been making the kind of power it's capable of making. Yesterday, the car was firing properly on all cylinders, and it let me know that the thing was working properly, and it shook the tyres quite hard twice.
Well, Al finished up in our number four qualifying spot here at Super Series number three with a 7.14. Leading the Pro Modified Championship is Andy Robinson. But if you remember back to Super Series number two, he wrote off his Rover in spectacular style. Let's make sure he's perfectly okay.
Now, that was such an incredible crash. I mean, I can still live through it. Just thinking back of what happened to you. Just tell me what happened. Just take me through the crash in your own words.
Well, the car got light as we went through the top end. The wing came off. I wasn't aware of that at the time. But when I lifted, obviously the car had no mechanical or aerodynamic downforce. The car went to the left initially, which I counter-steered. And then it snapped hard right, and I knew that I wasn't going to hold it.
Now, it seemed to, at one point, come to a halt, and then seemed to go on rolling again. What happened there?
Well, I can assure you it was not coming to a halt. The ground was very close to me, and I could see it, and it was not slowing down.
So it continued to roll. What were your thoughts when you were inside there? I mean, it must have been like the worst roller coaster of your life.
It's funny, really. I was hanging on, really. Jerry, one of my crew, crashed a car here a while back, a few years ago, and he told me a few things about the crash. And obviously, he hurt himself slightly. He broke his leg and stuff because he came out of the car. And I was very concerned about keeping my arms and legs within the confines of the roll cage, which is what I did. And I just hung on and waited for it to stop, really.
Did you at some point think, hey, I've had enough of this?
Yeah, about halfway through the rolls, it was starting to hurt then.
Now, you came out of that just with a couple of black eyes, basically, didn't you?
Sure, yeah. I mean, that's got to be down to the safety equipment we run, the standards that we build the cars to, and, of course, the speed of which the safety guys got to me and everything. I mean, that's got to have a big thank you to all the safety and paramedics that we have at this facility.
Well, Andy's here this weekend crewing for Bert Engelfield. A man who created some surprises in Pro Stock Bike was Netherlands' Herman Driel.
Yesterday you qualified third. Things obviously went quite well.
Yeah, everything goes well. We are still busy with the setup for the bike, so he can be faster.
It's a new bike. You've only been on it six times, I understand.
Yeah, that's right.
Tell us a bit about it. What sort of bike is it?
It's a Suzuki engine. 1327 capacity, 285 brake horsepower. The weight is 605 pounds total weight, including riding.
And what do you think of the competition? You've got Paul Willis and Dave Beck in the same class. Now, Paul's won the Super Series twice already. How do you feel about them?
It's good, hard competitors. I don't know if I beat, but I will try and do my best.
Well, it's not men only in Pro Stock Bike. Kerry Visick is back with us this weekend, the lady from Southampton. Let's hear how she's getting on.
This weekend is your first outing in the Super Series this year. How did qualifying go yesterday?
The first run wasn't too good. We improved quite a bit for the second run. We over-anticipated the track. We assumed it was a lot better than it was, so we got it wrong first run. Second run was a big improvement. And we went out for a practice run at the end of the day to see if we could improve for today. We didn't get that quite right, but we've gone back a bit now, so hopefully we should get today's setting a bit better.
Supercomp then, semi-finals, and the two Brogy Roadsters coming out together. That's going to be a photographer's dream, John Webster and Tim Adam. And in the second half of the ladder, we're going to be looking at these two. Paula Atkin in her Ford 100E against Alex Nicol in his Camaro. There's the burnout from the man from West Kings down near Brands Hatch in Kent. And Paula Atkin from Daventry, not that far away from the racetrack here at Stratford-on-Avon. But Mr. Magic Fingers does it again. Alex Nicol, his reaction time's absolutely faultless. He takes the win, a 47 reaction time, runs through 9.20. Paula chased hard but could not catch him. Well, both of these men in these Brogy Roadsters, Tim Adam in the orange car, John Webster in the yellow and silver car, have had a busy weekend here at Avon Park. They've both been running in Supercomp, they've both been running in Supergas, and here they are in the semi-finals. And Tim Adam knows he's really got to pull one out here if he wants to beat John Webster. Webster is the current championship leader, but it's Webster with the 0.44 reaction time, takes the win, 8.95. He's through into the final to meet Alex Nicol. Pro Stock Bike, these are the final four. They're all on. Suzuki's Willis against Paget, Beck against Hope, And Willis and Paget are the numbers one and two men in the championship at the moment. Here's Paul Willis looking to the front. Here's Len Paget. Lenny looks across, just keeping the power going on these 1500cc four-valve machines. When they get going, they change gear using an air shifter. There's a pro light in front of both riders on the shield. That tells them when to change gear, a push of the button, and they're moving up through the gearbox. But is anybody going to be able to stay with Paul Willis? Len Paget has been doing so well this year and loses with a 7, but it's Willis who takes the win with a 7.65. My goodness me, the championship leader seems fairly unassailable. Well, Chris Hope, closest to the camera, the man from Hull, doing very, very well this weekend, although Stratford-on-Avon hasn't been a lucky track for this man. Finds himself up against Dave Beck. Beck was our number two qualifier here this weekend with a 7.88. Chris Hope chasing hard, but Beck has him covered. Takes the win, 7.75. That was a good race. Lose out, 7.95, and they're both in the mid 160 mile an hour mark. Semi-final time, Pro Modifieds, and all of our leading championship contenders are out. John Ellis has a bye run. Phil Englefield runs against Al Cook. Phil Englefield, Bert to his friends, has got Andy Robinson. There he is, standing by the car. Let's have a quick word with Liverpool's Al Cook.
Al, what are your feelings now? We're looking forward to the semi-final.
Yeah, we're just waiting in the car, getting our thoughts together and concentrating on the lights.
Who are you on? You made it through to the semis. Things have been going well today.
Yes, we're very pleased. Yes, it's the first weekend we've used the gas and it's coming together well.
How's the car been handling out on the strip?
Absolutely superb. Yeah, it drives just like a road car once you've left the line.
John, there is nothing about these machines which faintly reminds me of a road car at all. 200 miles per hour, 2,000 horsepower, the quarter mile in 6 seconds. That's a road car. Let's see how we get on. Al Cook with the Corvette, the red Toyota of Bert Englefield. Al pulls a red. He is all over the track. Bert Englefield reacts with a 0.75. He takes the win, 6.90, 200 miles per hour, and Al Cook's race is run. Well, the other side of the ladder then puts this man, John Ellis, in his Vauxhall Calibra. Very, very happy. An all-new team working on this previous championship-winning car. He's on a bye run through into the final. Let's see how he gets. Oh, and a huge explosion. That's nitrous oxide. Well, that doesn't do an awful lot for the engine or for the bodywork. You actually saw the hood and the scoop lift there. Hopefully, John Ellis is perfectly A-OK inside the car. The fire crew on it straight away just to make sure there aren't any flames licking around the underside of the car. Hey, that was a close one, but you're going to build up. If something goes wrong with the mechanics of the engine, you get that explosion. Here's John.
John, it was all looking so good, but unfortunately, it's all gone a bit wrong.
That's right, yes. We don't quite know what happened yet. Speaking to the crew chief, we think the rev limiter's fouled and we left at too high RPM. The tacho's indicating that it flashed around to 8,000 RPM as I lifted my foot, so that's too high.
What went through your mind? It was a massive flash of fire coming out of the bonnet there.
Well, I actually didn't see it as badly as the people on the outside, because I'm looking forward. So I wasn't looking at the bonnet, so I didn't actually see the fire until I realised there was a severe lack of power.
Well, with rain coming down, the championship leaders remain the same. Paul Willis in Pro Stock Bike, Andy Robinson in Pro Mod, and John Webster in Super Comp.
I just cannot believe this, that after the fantastic weather that we've had here at Avon Park, we've now been subjected to an absolute downpour. It's stopped the racing. That's it. Well, we hope you've enjoyed what you've seen here from Super Series number 3. We'll be back for Super Series number 4, Stratford-on-Avon, Avon Park Raceway, for the battle of the top fuel giants. Barry Schiebels from Great Britain, Rico Antes from Germany. Who's the quickest in Europe? You'll find out if you come along to the track. You'll find out if you watch our programme. Welcome back to Avon Park Raceway. How do I know I'm back at Stratford-on-Avon? Well, the sun is out. We've got a glorious crowd here this weekend, the biggest crowd we've seen all season. It could be that it's something to do with Top Fuel Dragsters. We've got Top Fuel Drag Racing back here at the park after a 2-year gap. Everyone's very, very excited about that. And you know, 1999 is the 40th anniversary of the birth of the mini car. And those little minis have a bonnet which is at the most 2 foot long. Well, how would you feel if you were in one of these Top Fuel cars and the bonnet there was 19 feet long? How would you like to have a go in one of these? Well, this, of course, is Super Series number 4, featuring these Top Fuel Dragsters, and it's the battle of the titans, the clash of the titans, to see who is the quickest in Europe. Barry Scheibels, whose car we're looking at here, is the official FIA record holder, and coming out to do battle with him this weekend in these 6,000 horsepower monsters from Germany is Rico Antes. Here's Barry. Barry, welcome to Avon Park. I can't tell you how nice it is to have Top Fuel Dragster here with us. Feeling good?
Yeah, pretty good, John, thanks. You know, same applies to me. I'm really glad to be here at Avon Park. I love the people and I love the track, so just try and get this monster down to the other end and set a few records.
Well, tell me a little bit about this monster, because it is an all-new monster this year, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a brand-new car from the States. It's an ex-Joe Amato trailer car. That means it's brand-new but never run. And all the components came from an Amato stable. So it's full 1998 spec. And we brought it over, put it together, and we've been around Europe, basically, really, on a testing curve. So, you know, when we used to talk about cars having 5,000 horsepower and then 5.5, and we knew that you needed 5,500 horsepower to run a 4-second, 300-mile-an-hour pass, well, we knew we had that when we did it at Santa Pod. But this monster produces 6,000 horsepower, and it really does produce it. And the problem we're having at the moment is to try and reduce the horsepower so the track conditions can take it.
Wow.
Yeah. But it's a beautiful car. It goes straight, and it's so fast, it's unbelievable.
Well, certainly all of the British fans are going to be behind Barry Scheibels. But let's have a word with the man who's come over here to do battle. Rico Antes, of course, the man who is the promoter at Hockenheim Raceway, as well as being a Top Fuel pilot. Rico, a huge welcome to you to Avon Park. Nice for you to be here.
Well, of course it's nice to be here, especially when you go somewhere just racing and not promoting a race.
Yeah, because you're such a busy man. You've just come off of the back of your Hockenheim meeting. Was that good?
Hockenheim was brilliant this year. I mean, we had a major crowd, record crowd, 62,000 people over the weekend, and everything went well, despite the fact that Danielle crashed the Top Fueler and she had no injuries herself, but she was very sad that she couldn't be together with me in the final.
Now, you won the final then out there?
Yes, I beat the American guy Clay just a bit on the tree and all the way down to the top end also, so I think we proved that we're not the poor guys here in Europe. We can run as fast as the Americans.
So you're feeling pretty buoyant coming over here, feeling very, very good at the moment then, and you're up against Britain's Barry Scheibels.
Yeah, we feel pretty good. The car's all right. We had a major tire shake yesterday. You saw that we broke even some struts on the chassis. So, we need to calm down the thing a little bit, take some horsepower out, and we'll probably go down the track real fast.
On to Supergas then, the 990 class, and these two cars, the Brogy Roadsters of Tim Adam and John Webster, are running in Supercomp and Supergas. Andy Marriott caught up with John Webster.
John Webster, fastest in Supergas, must be happy with that.
Yeah, we're really pleased, considering we're running the two classes. We were struggling in the earlier rounds of qualifying because we made a few changes to the car and the car was going so quick, so we just persevered with it and found our feet in, and here we are.
Find it difficult to run in both classes, gas and comp?
No, the car seems to not give us any kind of problem with the heating or anything. The only problem we seem to have is at the start of the day the car runs slow. We think it's going to run at a certain time, the car runs slow, and then once the car's got some heat into all the lubricants and stuff, then we're back to where we want to be with the index. So we just sort of have to play a little game in the first qualifier to sort of get the heat into the engine, really. We guess we're going to run a bit slow, we put a little bit more in and it's there, so.
What about getting your brain into a super gas or super comp mode?
I just go to the tree and do the same thing. The car does the rest. We just got a little timer in the car. We change the timer, and if providing we remember to do that, we should be okay.
Towing silently down the fire up road come our two 300-inch-long monsters, the Top Fuel Machines. Yes, the British Bulldog. This is the man himself, Barry Scheevels. The crowd are here. They flocked along to Avon Park to see this man up against Rico Antes. This is going to be their first outing here on Elimination Day. They both had a practice launch away from the start line here yesterday on qualifying day. And now what they've got to try and do is get all of the power of these Top Fuel dragsters onto the track. Here we go with the burnout. Rico Antes, very, very nicely controlled. You know, if he went for that burnout and the butterflies on the bug catcher were to fly open, he could explode the engine. These machines use so much fuel that if you accelerate too hard in them, it puts too much fuel in the engine. If it can't be burnt, they hydraulic the engine. So it all has to be done to a set pattern. Here's Barry Scheevels in the Wims car. Up to the start line with these two. We're looking for electric 0.40 start line reactions, and then we're looking for a run in 5 or 4 seconds. Look at the power of these two machines as they thunder down the track. They both come out of it just before the finish line. There's Rune Field, the Norwegian, who is crew chief on both of these cars. But the first blood goes to Barry Scheevels. 5.4 to a 6.16 for Rico Antes. And were the crowd ever happy about that? We made a break in the rules here and actually towed Barry Scheevels back down the track to receive the adulation of this massive crowd here at the Super Series. Let's watch that again. And away from the start line, you can really see the power of these machines, those rear wheels growing. And actually, if you're at the side of these machines, the whole of that 300-inch long chassis is flexing as it makes its way down the track. First win goes to Barry Scheevels. Who is going to be the quickest in Europe? Let's have a look at the ladder. Nick Davis finds himself against Gordon Appleton. And the surprise of the meeting is John Ellis is on a bye into the final, having beaten the number two qualifier. That was Al Cook. Right, now then, Gordon Appleton then. The big burnout. Right the way through, trying to get some rubber strips down on that start line. Here's the Kendall car with Nick Davis in the hot seat, the man from Berkshire, works out of Southend where he runs a business with his crew chief. But these two American cars, Camaro and also Bill Cutlass, and they're away together. Start line reactions of 48 for Nick, a 53 for Gordon, and Gordon in chase mode. Who's going to take the win? Nick Davis takes it. Great race. 6.80 for Gordon Appleton. Wasn't good enough to catch Nick's 6.82 at 207 miles an hour. As the crew exchange greetings. I wonder if they are really as nice as they look. What do you think? But it is through into the final, Nick Davis, and that is really going to help his championship chances here at the Super Series. Remember, we've only got one more race meeting to see after this. John Ellis really getting to terms now with this Vauxhall Calibra. Got one of the smallest engines in there in class, and when I say small, it's round about 8,500 cc's. The big guys use 11,000 cc engines, but that's good. 7.49, 184 miles an hour. We move into semi-finals of Pro Stock Bike. It's an all-Suzuki affair. It usually seems to be that way these days. And our first pair puts the man leading the championship, Paul Willis, against Chris Hope. And bad luck has struck with Chris Hope yet again. He hasn't been able to put in a run, so it is Paul Willis on his own. Cracks off a 56 reaction time, runs through 7.54, 177 miles an hour. That man just gets quicker and quicker. Here's the other side of the ladder then. Dave Beck against Len Paget. These two are vying for the number two spot in the championship this year. Beck closes to the camera. Paget gets away first, a 47 reaction time to a 57 reaction time for Dave Beck. So head towards the top end, it's Dave Beck who takes the win. A 7.66 to a 7.81. Len Paget's going to be happy losing with that one. That's his quickest ever time. Well, here we go. Excitement time. Adrenaline starts pumping again. These Top Fuel pilots still have to push their own cars, you know. They're not that much of a star. It gives you a chance to have a look at these massive power plants they have in here. Running with two magnetos, so you've got two spark plugs for every cylinder. They're V8 engines, purpose-built V8 engines, of course. And here's Rico, the little leap into the six-point roll cage, which is a proper shell which sits round the driver. And now the strapping in process. That takes some time. They have to be strapped in and then strapped in again. Here we go with the burnout. This is Barry. Sounding very, very sweet indeed. All eyes, everybody is focused on the track. Rico Antes in the Dakota car. Barry Scheibel's in the Wins car. Here we go. We're looking for a four-second run. And they've overpowered the track. There goes the blower belt from Barry Scheibel's car. Well, they were saying earlier on that he was producing so much power that trying to get all of that power down onto the track is almost an impossibility. Barry takes the win, two in a row, but not the sort of times and speeds we were expecting here at the park. We were looking for a four-second run at 300 miles an hour, and there is the guilty item, the broken blower belt. So that has come off during that run, retrieved there by one of the safety safaris. Let's have a look at that again. It all looks good on the start line. The flames licking up from those headers, but then suddenly it all goes wrong. Barry lights up those rear tyres. Rico also has a problem. And we move into the final of Pro Modifieds. And this puts Nick Davis against this man, John Ellis. Could he be a giant killer? This really would be a turn up for the books if he was to dispose of Nick Davis in the final. Remember, he's running a smaller engine. He's a comparative rookie in this class. He's an experienced drag racer. That's Ray White there just turning on the nitrous. So the big Kendall car gets away first. Nick Davis, hole shots. John Ellis, a 58 reaction time to a 68. And the Kendall car doesn't let go. 208 miles an hour terminal speeds he's been running this weekend. 6.73. Here's Tim Adam. Remember, 40 years of age. Is he going to be celebrating? He's up against the man with the electric start line reactions in the other Brogy Roadster, John Webster. John looks across, see what's going on as they head up towards the start line. These two cars really are a picture. If you're a hot rodding fan like I am, you just love these two. Away from the start line, and John Webster pulls a red light, automatically hands the win to Mr. 40-year-old Tim Haddam from Camberley in Surrey. Will be celebrating. He takes the win. They both break out. It doesn't matter. Tim has automatically got the win, courtesy of that red light on the start line. Here's the final, then, of Pro Stock Bike. Now, then, with Dave Beck in yet another final, I think we'll find at the end of this particular meeting, he will have moved up into the number two spot in the championship behind Paul Willis. The man from Nantwich and Cheshire gets ready for the burnout. 1500cc Suzuki machine based around a Suzuki GSXR, but lowered Kevlar carbon fibre bodies on these machines. They use the bodywork to channel the air into the carburettors. Almost the type of supercharging without a mechanical device. Those long wheelie bars at the back, designed to keep the front wheel down. Well, here we go. We're looking for great start line reactions between these two. And it's a red light. Dave Beck pulls a red light. He hands the win to Paul Willis. And Paul takes it 7.59. He's been in those 7.5s all weekend. He's now at the top of the championship. Let's meet some of the winners.
Tim, you got the goodies there. You had a very good run today.
Yeah, I did, yeah. It was what I wanted, really, and it was pretty hard getting there, but we got there in the end.
Why was it so hard?
It just was, because we were running two classes, and it just at the end of it, it was just getting so tight and so close between the runs, and John and me were just doing, you know, pretty good times, and it was just real close.
It's been an excellent meeting, and Barry, bad luck to you. I guess you threw a belt off there in that last run.
Well, what happened really was that on the previous run, it ran so well over the eighth mile, went quicker and faster over the eighth than our four-second run, and the 297, and we tried to step on it a little bit too much, shook really badly, got the tyres up, smoking, and threw the blower belt, pulled a lot of revs, really.
Well, Rico, I think you shot pretty badly on that run as well. Is that why you backed off?
Yes, really. I mean, I'm still seeing white and black marks. It was, I don't know what's wrong with the track. It has some sort of a change of the conditions on around the 60-foot mark. So we didn't have time to really adjust for that on the clutch. So every time we stepped on it, it kind of shook from that point on.
Well, you're going to come back.
Well, we have to. I mean, I don't want to go back with this, the impression I am only capable of doing 11-second runs. So we should be here for doing something in the low fives and even going a little bit quicker maybe next year.
Well, this is the ground here, ladies and gentlemen, where we have just experienced top fuel back here again at Avon Park. This ground shook to 2 6,000 horsepower cars out here strutting their stuff. Unfortunately, no new records. Barry Scheevels now considers that he is the quickest in Europe. Rico Antes says he wants to come back next year and contest it again. We'll have to wait and see. Don't forget, we'll be seeing more great action from Avon Park in just a week or so's time here on World Motorsports. Welcome back to Avon Park Raceway in Stratford-on-Avon for our second look at Super Series number 4. Well, we've had two fantastic days of qualifying. We've got an empty track here at the moment, but that's going to be soon beating to the sound of massive engines doing battle. Let's have a look and see who's here. We're back with Top Alcohol, and this is Dave Wilson. That's his crew chief, Barry, just moving away, and Dave has got some mega problems here. Well, this is maybe where Dave gets that grumpy name from. Certainly there are problems here. He cannot get any drive through the clutch on the dragster. He is very unhappy. This is drag racing. You get up to the start line. It's all working perfectly when you try it out in the pits, and you get to the start line and it all goes so desperately wrong. So, to the other side of the elimination ladder. So we have, therefore, nobody on the, that was a semi-final run, and this is a semi-final run, so we have nobody coming up the other side of the semi-final. So this race between the dragster and the funny car of Rob Turner and Lex Yoon is technically going to be the final. Here we go with the burnout then. Just watch this. Lex Yoon loves showing off in front of the crowd here at the park. And a big, big smoky burnout from the Ford Probe. Right now then, Rob Turner from Higham Ferries in Northamptonshire. A smaller burnout from him. His brother Steve is the crew chief, does all of the work on that particular machine. And certainly at this point in time, Turner is the man looking to consolidate his win in the championship this year. And away together, reaction times, a 54 for Rob Turner, a 50 for Lex Yoon. But it's Rob Turner who gets the win, 6.20. He is our winner here in Top Alcohol this weekend. Back to the start line, and you can see Lex Yoon moves before Rob Turner goes. And those front wheels of Rob Turner's dragster pointing skywards for a while there. But then he comes back, a 6.20 run, takes the win, and he's the 1999 RAC MSA Top Alcohol champion. Well done. We move in to Super Comp, the 890 class. It's Alex Nicol pushing down. This is how it looks. He finds himself up against Zane Llewellyn from Bristol in that black dragster. And John Webster is on a bye run. So the burnout there for the blue Camaro of the man from Bromley in Kent, being walked back by Tony Grandston. On the other side of the track, we find the man from Bristol, Zane Llewellyn. Just look at the smoke inside that car. Here's Zane. Well, Zane, our number 4 qualifier, and Alex Nicol, our number 2. So this is going to be really, really close. We're going to be looking for excellent start line reactions here as we go up towards the staging beams that control the start line. Top beams come on, then the bottom beams, then the green. And Alex Nicol already in front. We're looking for 8.90 here as we head towards the top end. Well, it is 8.89 for Alex Nicol, but 8.91 for Zane Llewellyn. Zane Llewellyn takes the win. As we move on to the other side of the ladder, this is John Webster, another one of these men who's had a really busy weekend here at Avon Park. For this actual event, for the Supercomps, he just staged the car. Let's just see him against one of his Supergas opponents. Here, this is where he ran against Frank Mason, and Frank pulled a red, but it is John Webster who goes into the final of Super Comp.
Well, we move on into Super Street. This is Anne Peck. How far can this lady go? She really has made a name for herself here this weekend with her electric start line reactions and also running right on the index. Finds herself up against Bob Lee. Surely she's not going to be taken out. The consummate professional, and he pulls a red light. Lee's is out. Anne Peck is just cruising through for the win here. She doesn't have to go mad. She's saving the car. She's happy in the knowledge she's in the final. It was a red light on the tree for Bob Lees. Wow, he's out. And Peck is through. The other side of the elimination ladder is this man, Martin Green, with the Mark II console. Looks really, really nice, doesn't it? Don't forget, underneath the hood, big block Chevrolet power. And I think all he's going to do here is just go very, very slow. He's just going to stage, in actual fact. He is another one. He doesn't want to break the engine. He's just staged the car. He's through into the final. And he doesn't have to put in a run. That is classed as completing the run. So we'll see him in the final against Anne Peck just a little bit later. So here we are, the final then of Supercomp. The dragster against the roadster. And this is John Webster. Now, he is the man who reacts so very, very well indeed. We're always looking for 0.40 reaction times for him. But he's up against Zane Llewellyn, and Zane Llewellyn is no mean drag racer, the man from Bristol. Here we go. Well, look at this. John Webster, 0.409 reaction time. Zane Llewellyn, a 46, but Zane coming back. Look at that. Powers past him, gets there first and takes the win. Zane Llewellyn, 8.90 to a losing 8.96. Super Street. Martin Green against Anne Peck, the battle of the sexes. I don't think Anne Peck expected to get this far in competition. In the Rat Rage car, she really has done well here this weekend. So don't forget, we're looking for 0.5 reactions here. And then a run of 10.9, and Anne throws it all away. A red light for that red Camaro. She's out. Martin Green from Cheshire, the BT engineer who is 44 tomorrow, collects an early birthday present and takes the win, 12.06.
Martin, you've got the trophy. You must be very happy with today.
Absolutely delighted, because we worked so hard. We've been the underdogs, and it's been just great. I'd like to thank my crew and everyone at the Drag Racing Sport. It's just great. It's been a great day for me.
Bob, nice shiny trophy there. You must be happy with today.
Yeah, it's gone really well for us. We struggled a bit in qualifying, but it really come good today. The car was so consistent. In different lanes, it ran to within the thousandth, ran 6205 on both runs, so we're really happy with the consistency of the car.
Congratulations on winning Supercomp. You had a great day, of course.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a nasty weekend at the beginning because I had some trouble with the car, but come round okay in the end.
What did you have to do to sort it?
Well, it's pretty much I was having trouble at the top end, and it was just the way I was braking and stuff, really. It was me driving badly.
Well, there you go. Super Series number 4 is at an end. But we'll be back here at Avon Park Raceway. Believe it or not, Super Series number 5. That is for all the finals. We'll find out who are the champions in all the various classes. It's at the back end of September. You daren't miss it. Come along to the track. Watch it. Well, welcome, everybody, to Super Series number 5. And as you can tell, we're being weather affected here. The rain has been coming down all of the time. It's so unusual for the Super Series to be affected by bad weather. Whether we're going to finish this Super Series number 5 is in the hands of the gods. Let's see who's here. Well, I look so pained standing there in the rain. Never mind, let's turn our attentions to Supergas here on our finals day. It's very tight at the top of Supergas. Here's the number 4 man, Craig Gibbs. It's so tight, isn't it, at the top of Supergas this year?
Yeah, I think anyone in the top three can still take the championship. I think anyone in the top 10 can still take second in the championship. So we're all watching our backs, I think, at the moment.
Super Series, Luke, you're a fair few points in front of everybody else, but they're all telling me here today that they could catch you if they really, really tried hard.
I think they can catch us quite easy. I was looking at the points yesterday, and there's actually only 400 points in it between number 2, which surprised me because I actually thought I was in third place at this championship. So it's a pleasant surprise yesterday morning. We walked up there and seen the point standings. But there's quite a few guys can catch up with us. I think there's probably about 5-6 guys could probably still go on and win the meet.
You've won the championship.
Yeah, it's been a lot of work. We knew that we had to come to this meeting and just qualify. We've done enough at the European finals at Centerport a fortnight ago, and that's all we needed to do. Now, unfortunately, with the weather, not getting the opportunity to qualify yesterday, names out of a hat means we've qualified to, we've won both the Super Series and National Championships.
Feeling pretty good about that?
Yeah, very good. It's been a hard season, despite the fact we really haven't done too much damage. We've got the same eight pistons, same eight rods in it. So, yes, it's been a lot of work, but damage has been fortunately limited.
Well, Nick Davis very happy there that he knows he's won the championship, but in Super Street, it's not like that at all. We've got three top contenders here. We've just 70 points between them. Lee Morris, Bob Lees, and this man. With the team top banana car, this is Lee Huxley.
We're here at the final Super Series, Lee. Super Street is still wide open.
Yeah, it's anybody's race. It's the three of us in the championship that can win it. Worst scenario, I can come third. We're not looking to do that, but all we can do is our best. Destiny, I believe in that, so we'll do our best, we'll be there.
Bit frustrating for you this weekend, no qualifying yesterday.
Yeah, it's a bit awkward pulling out of a hat to qualify, but you know, upsets a few people. But that's drag racing, and if you haven't got the weather with you, then you've just got to do something. And that's the only way to do it.
Looking back over the series, you've had a pretty good season.
Yeah, we've had a lot of luck. The car's gone absolutely perfect. You know, we've driven it well, and it's all come together really. I mean, the sponsors have helped us. You know, Terry's made a great job of the track and organising. It's all gone great really. We've done well.
Well, it's our finals day and we have been visited by the rain quite often over this weekend, so the track preparation is meticulous as we move straight into Super Gas. And a quick look at some of our runners here. Spencer Tram with the Quantum Leap car finds himself up against Luke Ramage in the first round, which is a real hard one to call because, of course, Luke is the man currently leading the championship. Frankie Mason is in second spot. Peter Lane's in third spot, but not here for the final round. And Craig Gibbs sits in fourth spot. So Spencer Tram really has got it all to do here, up against the man leading the championship. We're looking for 0.40 reaction time. We get a 43 from Luke, a 50 from Spencer, and that's how it finishes up. Spencer Tram comes in second. Luke Ramage marches on, so he's still leading the championship. Well, the man currently in second spot in the championship, Frank Mason, finds himself up against this man, Roger Butterworth, with the 1957 Chevrolet Bel Air called Snow White. Had those flames put on the car this year, very much a hot rod type feature. Looks real, real good. The little Chevrolet Monza, though, in the opposing lane is Frankie from Newcastle upon Tyne. And he is the one that's within a gnat's whisker of that number one spot in Supergas. So how is he going to get on here? 0.40 reaction times, of course, are the order of the day, and then 9.90 on the run. Roger Butterworth being taken right up to the start line. Chevrolet and Chevrolet, of course. So here we go. Now then, it's going to be won and lost on the start line, I think, this one. We're looking for 0.4s. Here we go into the staging beams. The lights will then burn down. The green comes on, and it's the reaction to that green which really can win and lose a race. But they're almost identical. Just slightly better in Frank Mason's favour, but by a hundredth of a second only as we head towards the top end. It looks as though it's going to be Roger, but Frankie takes it right at the end. Let's hear from him.
What's happening with your car next year? Are you keeping it exactly the same as is? Are you just going to continue being Frank Mason cool dude and enjoy the racing?
Yeah, we do enjoy the racing. I've got the engine that I damaged to repair to get ready for next year. I have to sell the engine that I sort of borrowed then bought off Dave Clarkson, so I've got some jobs to do over the winter, yeah.
But you still think that you're going to be with us in the Super Series in the year 2000?
Oh yes, we'll really enjoy it. It's a lovely track, you know. I mean, we've had some rain. Well, this is the first time we've had any rain to spoil things, so it should be good.
Well, there you are. Are we going to see any more rain again? Those skies look particularly threatening at this point in time. As we bring out a little bit of entertainment for the big crowd that turned up here for the finals day, this is the Vampire Jet Dragster. Colin Fallows is the man who pilots this machine. Yeah, we do call it piloting a jet dragster. Runs an engine in there courtesy of Rolls-Royce that years ago would have been in a fallen gnat trainer. And there you are, records 8 seconds at 182 miles per hour. Quite extraordinary. Back on with the action then on finals day. The Ford Rapid Fit 100E of Daventry's Paula Atkin finds herself up against Alex Nicol, the man with those electric start line reactions in the opposing lane here in his blue Camaro. Paula Atkin in the full Rapid Fit car, in the full Rapid Fit lane. They sponsor a lane here as well, and it's all down to this start line reaction. Normally, Alex is the quickest away, but this time around, he's not. Paula gets a 64 to Alex's 73, but then Alex runs away with it, takes the win. 9.36, a good win for him. Into Super Street, this is the man leading the championship. Lee Huxley shares the driving with his father. That's his dad standing alongside there. And on a by run in the first round, should have been racing Andy Williams with the other little roadster, the yellow roadster, but Andy has packed up and gone home due to the look of the weather here at Avon Park. So it's a by run through for Lee. 0.53 reaction time, runs through 11.38. Well, here we are looking at something a little bit different. During the course of 1999, we have visited on the Super Pro ET races. We're just having a quick look at those as they come up for one of their rounds. This is Steve Green in his Mark 1 Cortina, but the car nearest the camera is a Ford Focus, commissioned by Ford of America. Wayne Saunders got the commission to build this car, and the whole idea of it is to go for the title of the world's quickest four-cylinder car. The machine is being shipped out to America. Wayne is taking on all comers. Let's just see how quick this rally-prepared engine goes with this Ford Focus bodywork wrapped around it. It's quick into the 7.94, 164 miles per hour. Look out, everybody else in the world. Wayne Saunders is coming your way. Let's hope he brings back that title. The quickest four-cylinder machine in the whole world. Okay, the pro mods are lined up, ready for battle. The man sitting at the front of the queue, Nick Davis, we spoke to him earlier on, the Kendall-sponsored machine, already knows that they're the number one in the championship this year. But everyone's a little bit concerned at the moment. That rain cloud overhead seems particularly dark and nasty now. As we point the camera skywards, down comes the rain. Well, these people are smiling, but everybody else just simply runs for cover. What? Well, there you are, rained off on our finals day. Not so good, and we didn't get a chance to see half of the people out there on the racetrack. So we thought what we'd do is put together a selection of the rest of the best. Well, left-hand lane, Paula Marshall finished up number 9 in the Super Gas Super Series Championship. Up alongside her, John Webster, one of the busy boys in the Super Series, running not only in Super Gas, but in Super Comp as well. Good to see Pete White back with us again. The man from Northamptonshire came in on the last event. Here's Kev Moore, a stalwart of the Super Series, been with us since we started in this big high-winged Willis. Well, the swoopy Beetleback car up against the Ford Capri. Pete White breaks out on that run, but let's hope we see him again with us in the year 2000. Son of the promoter, Craig Gibbs, in our first year was one of the youngest, now has to take second spot on that one to Spencer Tram. Here up against Sean Lathan in the Calibra. Sean is a man who is going to get better and better as the Super Series progresses through the forthcoming years. The Calibra, of course, one of these cars with the lowest coefficient of drag, built for drag racing. We've got quite a few of them in various classes. And this particular run, Craig Gibbs got the better of Sean Latham. Andy Williams. That beautiful little yellow roadster. Big block full power. Yeah, we're going to ride with Andy. There we go. Up against Lee Morris in the green with MVE type. I'm a Jaguar man myself, but I still love these little roadsters. And Andy driving hard after the E-type, but I think it's going to be Lee Morris takes it. He does. 11.19, looking for 10.9. Pro modifieds, haven't they been stars? Dave Pollen, Gordon Appleton. Pollen in the Mustang, Appleton in the Wheel Game racing car. They have been superstars with us. Back to Supergas, the man who's just retired, Jim McGee. Jim, we're going to miss you so much. Up against him, Martin Kerbishley in the big Camaro. McGee, always a hard competitor, as they head towards the top end here. Looking for 9.9. 10.04. Jim McGee takes the win. Superstreet, just that little bit slower, 10.9. This is Mark Watkins. Would you believe this started off life as a little 323 Mazda? Shoehorned underneath the hood there, a Rover V8 power plant. He's up against Bob Doiney in the Ford Pop, the Flying Doctor. And this machine really has been doing well. I think we're going to be seeing great things from Bob Doiney in the year 2000. He gets away first. Mark Watkins charging hard after him, but I think it's going to be Bob Doiney. And Mark Watkins got a lot of smoke out of that little Mazda. There we are, 11.43. Bob Doiney takes the win. Here's the man who ended up the 1999 Supergas champion, Luke Ramage, in the big Chevrolet Nova, up against Comrade Stanley from Bristol. You just see the nose of that pot poking through there. Absolutely superb stuff. Rob Long furthest away in his Camaro, up against Roger Butterworth. Rob Long, a new man to us in 1999. Let's hope he'll be back in the year 2000. Certainly got the power there with that machine. We had a look at Super Pro. This is a bracket racing class during 1999. It's an old friend of mine, Mick Kemp. We go back 20-odd years to when I used to DJ at the NASC Nationals. Known him a long time. There he runs through, 8.5 seconds. And in the same class, we get door slappers as well. The man with the wheels in the air, Nick Stevenson, Nigel Payne in the lane, closest to the camera. Wow, they're going great into the sevens. Two-wheelers as well, Pro Stock Bike. Chris Tombleson furthest away, Len Padgett closest on the White Lightning Suzuki. They're nearly all Suzukis. We've got one or two Yamahas and Kawasakis in this class. Most of them are Suzukis. From abroad, from Holland, Herman Van Driel crosses the centre line. Dave Beck from Nantwich in Cheshire takes the win. Back to Supergas again. The man who was looking so good at the start of the season, Peter Lay with the white Camaro. Up this time against Paula Marshall. Paula saying, where is he? Where is he? He's there somewhere. Who takes the win? Pete White. And this machine, George Chiarella. I absolutely love this car to death. It was based around a pro mod version of Nick Davis's old Supergas car. It's now been written off, unfortunately. A crash at Santa Pod put pay to George Chiarella's car, seen here racing against Tim Adam. And let's just have a final look at a car that was imported by Al Cook from America this year to do battle in Pro Modified. What a burnout. Well, here we are. Here's all of our winners. Supergas, Luke Ramage. Pro Modified, Nick Davies. Super Street Bike, Graham Dance. He had a great year with us at the Super Series. Super Comp, John Webster, hard worker. The Junior Dragsters, well, that was Katie Gibbs took the win there. Pro Stock Bike, well out in front, Paul Willis. Super Street, Lee Huxley. And Super Pro ET fell to Steve Green.
Well, there you are, ladies and gentlemen. Our video from the Super Series 1999, absolutely packed with explosive drag racing action. Well, we're going to be back here in the year 2000 for the Super Series again. They promise us the action will be bigger and better. Make sure you don't miss it.
goes the blower belt from Barry Schiebel's car.